Welcome again to our Tuesday evening teaching sessions, an opportunity to think together and to wrestle with some of those issues that challenge. Throughout this series, we've been trying to examine why some of those issues need to be revisited. It gives us simply the opportunity to go back to Scripture and to wrestle with what Scripture is trying to tell us. And of course, we live in a media-driven society where we're being constantly bombarded with views and attitudes. And it's so easy for us to become overwhelmed and emerged under the weight of all of that. So it's a great opportunity for us to have a fresh look at some of those issues that challenge. Last week, we looked at fundamentalism, and I think this gave us an opportunity to view not just fundamentalism within the Christian church, but in a wider setting, and why that has become a term that is very provocative for many people today. And of course, we allied that with that famous statement that people sometimes make. You can hear the horror in their voice. You're not one of those born-again Christians, are you? So we had a chance to view Christian fundamentalists, its core beliefs, where it's coming from, and a chance to think about how some of those very rigid views and the perception that people are denying the insights of science, primarily in the 21st century, and how that can be a barrier to people wanting to discover faith for themselves. This evening, we're going to follow on from fundamentalism to what's often seen as its enemy, really, or at least some within this movement see fundamentalists as the very bad people. And that, of course, is humanism. I think humanists sometimes see all Christians as fundamentalists. And of course, some Christians will make the assumption that all humanists are atheists. Well, neither is true, of course, and neither assumption is helpful. It doesn't lead to good, positive dialogue. A few years ago, lots of evangelical groups within this country and humanists clashed over bus adverts. Doesn't sound very significant, but it kind of captured something of where people were in relation to what was perceived as Christian fundamentalism, and of course, what was perceived to be a reflection of humanism. Many evangelical Christians led a campaign. They had built what became known as the Christian Party at that time, and there was lots of bus advertising going on. Some of them very traditional messages, like the fool has saith in his heart, there is no God, based in Scripture. But probably more provocative was this one. There definitely is a God, so join the Christian party and enjoy your life. Well, that was put out, and I guess it was perceived by humanists as being a very negative message. And so the British Humanist Association decided to respond, and they began to put adverts, slogans on buses too. And they led their own advertising campaign. And what they played on was the previous one, where join the Christian party, there definitely is a God. And their statement was, there probably is no God, so stop worrying and enjoy your life. Well, in one sense, that all seems a bit trivial, but it kind of really captures the misunderstanding between what's perceived as Christian fundamentalism and humanism. It wasn't a particularly positive or helpful thing, and didn't lead on to a very open dialogue and a debate between two particular viewpoints. We recognize, of course, we live in a multicultural, multiracial, and multi-faith society, and that Christianity, as we've said before, is no longer the dominant voice in our country. It's a voice amongst many voices. And we've also recognized, as we've gone through some of these teaching sessions and beyond them, that every person has a worldview. Everybody sees the world through a particular lens, through a particular perspective. And of course, we're going to look at two of those tonight, and we're going to compare them. The first one is what we might describe as the Christian worldview, and the second is the humanist worldview. Right from the very beginning, I want to make it clear that here we're talking about worldviews. We're not talking about people or individuals. This isn't about putting one group of people above another group of people. This isn't about saying that one group of people have got everything right and the other group of people haven't got everything right. This isn't even about saying that one group is a good example of a person and the other is a bad example of a person. Well, of course, none of that is relevant or true. It's just simply that there are different perspectives here, and we want to have a look at them in a way that opens up the possibility for dialogue and debate. We know right from the very beginnings, the origins of the church, way back in, as we see them in the book of Acts, that the church emerged, Christianity as a message emerged in a very multi-faith, multicultural, multiracial world. And at that time, Christianity stood shoulder to shoulder in the marketplace of beliefs and values, and proclaimed its message without any sense of apology. Proclaimed it with great authority and inspiration. And of course, the impact was immense. It didn't back off, and it didn't settle for a quiet life. And I guess today the call on the Christian church is to stand where our ancestors have stood. We are to stand in the marketplace, a place of varied beliefs and values, of worldviews, and we're to bring ours to bear in that context with a deep sense of grace, but also a deep sense of assurance and confidence that we have something to bring to the table that ultimately is very significant and very life transforming. This is where the church needs to be, and hopefully the churches that we belong to are at the forefront of that. Humanism is one amongst many worldviews. It too has to stand in the marketplace. And of course, it too has to campaign for a society that's built around its values. It's an organized movement at one level. And it's quite proactive. It focuses in on the British Humanist Association, which brings together people from a very wide range of backgrounds. Some of them would be atheists, and many of them would be agnostics. Humanists often feel very discriminated against. They often feel that their views do not stand alongside those of religious groups. They're not held in the same way and not given the same weight. So they become quite militant and quite active in trying to present an image of Christianity or other religions as being very medieval, very backward-thinking, very closed-minded in that sense. So they would oppose things like faith schools. They want all schools to be non-sectarian. They want assemblies in schools to be without any mention of religion or the existence of God. They want to stand alongside multi-faith groups because they want to express their views as being just as significant and just as important as any other religious groups. They will present or offer alternatives to religious funerals, weddings, important life cycle celebrations and moments of despair. Perhaps the most famous and the most active of humanists within the UK is Richard Dawkins, who wrote the book The God Delusion. Would I recommend reading it? I think, I certainly set out to read it. The only thing was that I found very quickly that the kind of Christian that Richard Dawkins was talking about was his assumption that all Christians are fundamentalists. And so his attack was on fundamentalism, really. So in one sense, I lost a bit of interest in it because I didn't feel he particularly was addressing me and where I come from. Humanists can be very friendly and welcoming and embracing of others. Also, they can be fundamentalists themselves and really quite aggressive in trying to get their viewpoint across and trying to present religion as a very negative thing. They have their own belief system, and their belief system is one that warrants serious attention. I need to say again that humanists are not bad people. In fact, quite the reverse. Many of our friends, many of people that we share life with would be humanists. They may not define themselves in that particular way. They wouldn't say, I'm a humanist. But the beliefs that they hold, their worldview, their world values, would suggest that they would fall into that particular grouping. So this isn't about saying people are bad. This is about examining understandings and views. So what do humanists believe? Well, fundamentally, they believe in individual rights and freedoms. They believe that people can and will find solutions to the problems that we face in our world. They believe in reason. Reason is the means of progress in that sense. They believe that people can and do lead good and responsible lives without any religious background or superstitions. Well, of course, as a Christian, I would want to say I agree with them. Well, almost agree with them. I think humans are, at their very best, quite amazing, and they do the most amazing things. In lots of ways, I think we are finding solutions to the problems that we face. This recent pandemic has shown an incredible ability of humans to begin to address the problem and to find solutions. And of course, as a Christian, I very much see that as a reflection of the fact that all humans are made in the image of God and therefore have such a great potential for doing good and for doing the right kind of things. But sadly, and it is a sad thing to say, humans aren't always at their best. And this is probably where I slightly differ or perhaps stronger than that, I would have some disagreement with humanism. Humans aren't always at their best. I'm not always at my best. Sadly, we don't seem to be always finding solutions to the world's problems. In fact, we seem to be creating more problems. And I don't think that's being negative. I just think that's reality. It's the real world in which we live. Jesus, of course, always looked for the good in people, and he saw good in people. But Jesus also was willing to challenge what wasn't good and wasn't right. He saw God's image upon their lives, but he also realized that at times humans display tendencies that do not reflect God's image upon their lives. And I think this is where humanism and Christianity differ. Humanism suggests we can work it out. And we have to work it out because we live in a closed universe. There is no God. All we have is what we see around us and within us. Now, Christians believe something different to that. It's not that they believe that humans are inherently bad. It's just we recognize that there is ingrained within all of us that tendency at times to not do things in the right way, to do things that are downright wrong or even evil. And that Christians believe that we don't live in a closed universe where we have to work all this out by ourselves. We actually live in a universe that God is active in, that God is engaged with, that God is involved in. And that there are things which only God can fix. Now, that's not to say that humans aren't incredible, that humans don't do the most amazing things. But humans can't do everything. And they can't work out everything by themselves. If we could, the world would be a very different place than it is today. There are things that God can fix that humans can't. And of course, that is to do with that inner struggle with sin and its effect upon our lives and our world, and how it's only God that can deal with that and has dealt with it in Jesus Christ. So Christianity and humanism, in one sense, share some common ground, but they also have points of difference. And those points of difference are where we need to engage and dialogue with those humanists that we know, our friends who perhaps hold very humanistic views. I don't know whether you see yourself as a pessimist or an optimist, whether you see the glass half full or half empty. I think in one sense, both humanism and Christianity struggle to hold a balance between the two, because the truth is the glass is half empty and it's also half full. It's not one or the other. And humanism, I think, tries to present itself as a very positive worldview, and in many senses it is. And then of course it tries to present Christianity as having a very negative view of the world. Well, sometimes Christianity has had a very negative view of the world and has projected that to its own loss. But you see, the truth is, as we look at our world, it is half full, but it's also half empty. It's not an either or. And I think Christianity comes to terms with that in a way that humanism can't. It's not to say that Christianity isn't positive about life. It's not saying that Jesus wasn't life-affirming. It wasn't that Jesus didn't see good in people and in the things around him. It's just simply that that wasn't the only thing to see. Also, the glass was half empty, that there were lots of things that needed challenging and changing and dealing with. And that's not something that humans alone can do within a fixed and closed universe. It's something that Christianity says can be dealt with, is being dealt with, has been dealt with by God through Jesus. And that God is in a process of bringing about transformation and renewal in our world through the presence of His Spirit and His church. That provides hope, but also it's an acknowledgement that not everything in life is good. And sometimes some of life is downright bad or even evil. I think to believe that human reason will solve all human problems, well, that does require a leap of faith. You cannot prove by reason that reason alone is the answer. Of course, you have to take a little leap of faith. Scientists do it all the time. They set out to prove something or to find out about something. Well, they're hoping that the outcome will be that they will discover something that's good. It requires a little bit of faith to set out on that that task. And so in our world, to say that faith has no place is to say that reason is everything. Well, reason isn't everything. Reason and faith can go hand in hand. We can reason logically, but of course we need faith to enable us to bring about some of those great advancements and the betterment of human life. And of course, to believe in human progress as this ongoing, unrelenting journey that we're on, to believe in human progress per se, I think is to go against all the evidence of our world. Are we really progressing in terms of the way that we care for our world? Or most of the time, do we seem to be going backwards? Is the environmental crisis that we're facing today, is that a sign of progress? Are the wars that we see around us and we're involved with through military engagement, is that progress? I think to say that progress is unrelenting and we're always progressing, I think we need to do better than that, because simply that doesn't always appear to be the case. There's no constant evidence to show that progress per se, human progress, is by nature going to continue. Again, this requires faith. And I think that's what Christianity does that humanism doesn't do. Christianity allows for both the good in humans as well as the bad. Whereas I would suggest that humanism allows for the good but has no place to recognize the bad and the evil in our world. And the fact that sometimes life, human history, is not this progressive movement, this journey, but sometimes it's very it's almost like a circle. It goes around and round and round. It cycles in that sense. Christians believe in human progress, but they also recognize at times that there can be human reversal. And I think that's where Christianity comes into play in relation to humanism, and why we can take forward with confidence a message that doesn't say everything's bad and everyone's bad. Quite the opposite. A message that says there is so much good and we see so much progress, but also we have to face the realities that sometimes there is so much bad, and sometimes we've got back into reverse gear rather than moving forward. And I think Christianity and its message of redemption and hope through Christ Jesus addresses that so much better than having a humanistic view does.